Welcome to part two of the Introduction to Juniper series. In part two, we're focusing on device configuration at a deeper level. We're kicking off in this video by looking at the active and candidate configurations. Juniper has an active config, which is the configuration that is running right now. When we run show configuration from operational mode, the active config is what we see. Let's make a quick change to this config by adding a VLAN. When we enter configuration mode, Junos creates the candidate configuration. To start with, this is a copy of the active configuration. This means that the changes we just made were in the candidate, not in the active config. While we're in configuration mode, we can use the show command to see the candidate configuration. Here we see the changes that we've just made. If we were to look at the config from operational mode using the run command, we would be looking at the active config, so we won't see our changes. If we were to run a commit, the candidate configuration would overwrite the active configuration. The config files are stored in the /var/runDB directory. The candidate file is named Juniper.data. This is not a file that you can simply open in a text editor. Here's a fantastic tip that you should definitely know. If you want to see the changes between the active and candidate configurations, pipe the show command through compare. Anything with a plus symbol has been added with the set command. Anything with a minus symbol has been removed. I'm going to put some bad config in now. This config won't work as this interface already has an Ethernet family unit, and we're adding an iNet family unit. We can't mix these two types on a single interface. You'll notice that this is not rejected by the CLI. After all, our syntax is correct, and perhaps we're going to fix up our config before committing anyway. At this point, we can run the commit check command. This will test the candidate to see if it's valid. It won't actually commit the config though. Of course, we'll see that fails. If we now remove the faulty config and check again, we see that there's still an error. Why might this be happening? Look at the candidate config for interface GE007. Notice that the extra unit is still there. We remove the IPv4 address, but not the whole unit. This is still invalid, so we'll remove that too. When we run commit check again, we see that it's all fine. While we're on the topic of committing configurations, here are a few more tricks. We can add comments while committing, which is helpful if we want to track changes that we're making. It's especially helpful if we want to roll back changes, which we'll see in the next video. We can also schedule a commit, which enables us to pre-provision changes that we want applied at a later time. We will have a closer look at this in the lab on the website if you want to check that out. Commit and quit is a great one. It commits changes and drops us straight back to the operational mode. And finally, commit prepare can speed up our commits in some cases. We'll look at that in the lab if you want to see more. What would happen if we were working on a large router, where it's likely that several other administrators are configuring at the same time? In a case like this, there is only one candidate configuration file. That means that we can override each other's changes. This is certainly not an ideal scenario. What can we do in this situation? The best practice here is not to use the regular configure command. Instead, we use configure private. When we do this, we're giving ourselves a private copy of the candidate configuration. If all administrators are doing this, no one will override each other. Keep in mind though, that a commit will not overwrite the other person's private candidate file. As soon as we enter private configuration mode, we are presented with a warning. Any changes that we don't commit will be lost when we go back to operational mode. Now, as I said, one user committing will not update the candidates of any other user. We need to do this ourselves with the update command. If we don't, we will not be allowed to commit. What happens if we have conflicting changes? Perhaps two users both try to change the host name. So in this case, the first will commit, and that will work, and then the next one will fail. The second user does have an option to force the changes if needed. There is a small caveat to be aware of. If you've moved to another part of the hierarchy with the edit command, you will get an error when you try to commit. When we have a private candidate file, we need to be at the very top of the hierarchy to commit. The simplest way to do this is to use the top command. What if you're making critical changes and you can't afford to have your config overwritten? That's where you'd use configure exclusive. In this mode, we're the only ones who get a copy of the candidate. No other users are permitted to make any changes. The lock on the candidate file is released only after we exit configuration mode. It's always a good idea to back up your configs. To do this, we can configure a feature called configuration archival. This takes a config file and automatically copies it to a remote FTP or SCP server. For this, we configure an archive site. The one shown here is an FTP server. Notice that the username is in the FTP path, and the password is listed at the end of the command. The password will be encrypted before it's stored in config. We also need to configure when the backups happen. The first option is a transfer interval, which runs a backup on a regular basis. The alternative, which I prefer, is transfer on commit, which backs up the config every time we run a commit. The config backup is created in the /var/transfer/config directory and uses a particular naming convention as shown here. The file is then moved to the archive site and a syslog entry is generated. As an extra level of protection, we can configure more than one site. These additional sites are only used if the first one is unavailable. I hope all of that is sinking in well. Of course, if you have questions, you can put them in the comments section here or over on the website. I'm sure you'll agree that the active candidate commit model is one of the best reasons to use Juniper. Click the video shown here, and we'll start looking at how to roll back our configuration to previous versions.